Colleagues, good afternoon. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm going to repeat what other people said, that what a wonderful welcome we've had here in Vienna. It's been a beautiful city, beautiful weather, and the warmth of our friends, everybody here, has been much appreciated. Harald and his colleagues have been made we greatly welcome. And so this afternoon, I have to give you an aperitif of the next two talks. They are going to be much more detailed than me. I'm going to be much more general. They've told me that I must be very careful to be sure that you're all awake after lunch and that I must not talk more than 15 minutes. So that's my duty, and I hope it will be interesting for you. What I thought I would do is I would talk about a little bit of history to bring in where the past leads us into what will be the future. And that's what my job today will be. So we have to... No, it's not happening. Nope. Shall I do this one? Okay. Well, stadiums are very important. This afternoon, we are going to talk about spectator facilities. And this morning, of course, a lot of the talks were about participation, but there is a great echo of similarity of the same problems that exist. And when we talk about the future, I just quoted Albert Einstein for you. He said, I don't think very much about the future. It happens, it comes soon enough. But in fact, that's not good enough for us. We have to think about the future. We have to think about where we are going. And I'm quite interested in this man, Juvenal, who is a Roman poet, from the Roman times, who wrote quite a lot. He was a very cynical poet, but he wrote this famous phrase, which was that the common people, they don't care about their freedom or democracy or any important issues. They only interested in bread and circuses, which means they are only interested in food and entertainment. And I think this was something that happened in those days in the past, and maybe we have echoes of that for today. But Juvenal was also famous for what we heard this morning in the opening speech about a sound mind and a sound body. And that's mens sano in corpore sano. It's a very important phrase used a lot in the Olympics, but it was Juvenal who wrote it. And so I now just wanted to talk about a little bit of history, that's all. This is the ancient Olympia Stadium. It could hold 20,000 spectators, and it was an event where people ran up and ran back. The men ran naked. They wore no clothes. And they did allow women to watch this race, but only women who were not married. The women who were married were not allowed to watch these men because it would make their husbands very jealous and very difficult. And so the other thing about that was that this was Olympia, so it was, we know what the Olympics are, the competition, and we heard today, but in fact we talked last night with our colleagues about Sparta. In Sparta, the race was run by women who also wore no clothes. And the reason for the Sparta being different was that Sparta was a very warlike country, and they wanted the women to be strong and healthy so they would be the mothers of the warriors and the fighters. And so that was the difference between Sparta. But then we moved to, of course, spectator sports in Rome, in the whole Roman Empire, and this is where we know what happened, these wonderful buildings, which today we almost can't equal in terms of the quality and the nature of what they did. They could have a roof, they could have, every spectator was seated, and of course the escape matters were very comparable to the escape of today. They had wonderful access in what they did. And what's also interesting about those buildings is, oh my God, I've gone right. I'll just have to go back right to the start. Sorry about that. That in some cases we are modernizing these old buildings, because with sustainability we have to think about reusing. And this is Verona, where they're thinking about using it with a new roof. And that will be a wonderful occasion to use these old buildings from the past in a new way. And that leads us really to what I'm going to say today. And that's about, though in the Middle Ages there were no stadiums. All the events took place in cities, and they built special occasions, temporary facilities. This is Verona, where they have horse racing, and this is Florence. And so all of the events of the Middle Ages did not have stadiums. We built those later. And that's what we're going to hear from Tom and this afternoon, and Mike, and that's going to be very good. Now, the modern stadium must not be an icon. It must be a wonderful building, but it must be practical. It must work, and it must have a future, and we must think about the sustainability. Tom is going to mention the O2 Arena in London. It's a very successful arena, holds maybe 25,000 people. But what's interesting about this building is it's become a destination. So 3 million people visit the O2 Arena every year to see something. But 6 million people just visit it. They just go there because there are lots of things happening, restaurants and things, activities to climb the roof, etc. So that's a lesson. And then we come to this point about the future. So new technological developments are allowing now us to think in a new way about stadiums and spectator facilities. More sophisticated camera techniques and everything about all the equipment that we now have will enable us to understand the policies of what is going to happen to the stadiums. And we can't forget, and Robin Kaler mentioned it today, sustainability. We have to look after the planet. All facilities, we have to be thinking, they must be healthy, they must be good for the planet and good in terms of energy and good for what's going to happen in the future. So this is, in a way, my subject. We're going to remember what Juvenal said, that people were only interested in food and circuses. That's all they wanted. But now people go to the stadium. We heard this morning from our colleagues that something like 55% of people are not involved with sport, and these are the people in Denmark that they're going to look to. But it happens now with modern stadiums that the same kind of proportion is happening. 55% of the people who are in the stadium are going to watch the event. They're going to watch the game. But another 45% are not going to watch the game. They're just there to be entertained, and they go and have food, they go and look at other facilities. We showed you that picture of the swimming pool, whereby the Americans are thinking very much about making this a place to go and to be alive in a very, very big way, not just a place to sit and watch the game. Tom will tell you more and much more about that later this afternoon. And these are some drawings of the populace think tank. And I think all it says is, what are we going to have stadiums of the future? What will they be like? Robin showed us this morning the picture of the space, which was multipurpose. And I think, in a way, that's what we think might be able to happen in the future with stadiums, that they become places where there are activities and they are part of the city and not separate. And that's why I chose to say something about Siena and the Middle Ages, those old festivals. We may be returning a little bit to those kind of places and the way in which they are designed. And so that's these are just some visionary drawings of what the stadium of the future might be like. And who knows what we are going to be possible to build in the future. This is a drawing, very much like we saw this morning, of things happening in the city. In future, the stadium can be many things for many sports. It can be part of the city, and it can be different from the kind of stadium that we have seen in the past. This is a drawing by the architects here will know the name Sir Peter Cook. He was the architect of Archigram, kind of future thinkers. And this is what he gave. And then the last thing I wanted to show you is we also then put out an idea of thinking about what the stadium of tomorrow will be like. And this was published in the National Geographic magazine. It went out to the world. Millions of copies were sold. And so we've put this message about what could happen to stadiums. And I hope that it picks up many messages that we have heard this morning, but that this we're going to hear about later with Mike and with Tom, and saying what are the changes happening. This stadium is just a kind of idea, but you can see we put some greenery on the roof. Greenery we heard of is very important for life. You have to have trees, you have to be nature, you have to be sustainable. And it's sort of a health. We wanted these buildings to be healthy buildings. It will be multi-purpose. We can put on events in this building on either of the two floors that can do anything that you want, that will be for viewing different sports and different activities and maybe the kind of interesting challenges that we heard about for the new sports of the future. So on the one side, we see that this is a very comfortable stadium, very wonderful. Everybody can see, everybody is going to be fed very well. And maybe they're also going to be doing something else in the stadium with the people who are there, with the families and with the guests who are not so interested in the sports facilities as many of the strong spectators are. And so that's something that's going to happen. And this is the other shot showing maybe something on the roof. Why not? Using solar energy, using landscaping, making it an underground access coming through. This is it could be good for Vienna because they could come through the river underneath into the stadium. Who knows? It's just ideas that I wanted to put to you today to open your minds before you hear the practicalities of what Tom and Mike will tell you. And so we also heard a little bit questions about safety. We can't avoid the fact that we live in a troubled world, that big events can be damaged by terrorism, by accidents, by all kinds of things that go on. But we want the stadium, this is the London Stadium, this is the London Olympic Stadium, built for the London Olympics, then transformed afterwards, which Tom will tell you about, into a stadium for football. So it was a stadium which had a legacy, and it, of course, was part of the total regeneration of the city, which is something I think that we all have to do. Whatever we do can be very important for the future of the city. It can regenerate the places where we live. And this is, again, the London Stadium. It's set in the Olympic Park, where there was recent seminars that we held. But it's a beautiful place, and it's now changed this part of London. People love to live here, and they are moving museums, they are moving universities to this part of London because the transport and everything is so good with the parks. And then Tottenham Stadium, Tom will talk about that, so I don't want to say much about it, except that it's a case whereby we are thinking of upgrading the city, regenerating the city, making the stadium and the spectator places that people want to go to enjoy themselves, not only to watch the match and not only to participate. So I think that's all I wanted to say to you. I hope it's been a good aperitif for the people who will follow, full of ideas, maybe a bit crazy sometimes, maybe a bit different, but it's something that I think very important that we all think about. And thank you very much for staying awake after lunch and also listening. Thank you very much. Vielen Dank.